We're going to talk about the water of the laver today in the tabernacle of God. The water. The water, the water, the water. The water is what cleansed the spots off of the priest's robes before they went into the holy place of God. And, you know, it's the blood that took away the sin, it covered the sin. It was the blood of the sacrifice and the burning of the altar and those things that took place on the altar. But it was when the priest had to go into the tabernacle, the priest had to look in the brazen laver and had to wash himself and make himself clean. Amen? Anybody know that? Hopefully you know that. If you don't know that, you're going to have to catch up real fast. But I just want to share with you a few things. I didn't finish Sunday night or Wednesday night about the blood. If you want that, it's all right here, and you have to decipher the scribbling and have to just go through it. But if you want some of that, I will let you have that. It's free of charge. I don't have the tape table out today. And so it's free of charge. You can have that. Has anybody else hot? I'm burning down, man. I know it was a little cool this morning when I got in there this morning, and I don't think we turned any air on, but it is hot to me, and if someone could handle that, someone behind me could handle that. Okay, I mean, I appreciate that. We're talking about water. Someone said water.
Water.
Water. How many like water?
Man.
Ah. I don't know who got it, but it was either Jim or it was Mark. And I appreciate them, whoever did it. Amen. I love them very much for doing that. Water, universally needed for life, water. No water, no life. I mean, you can go a long time without food, but you can't go very many days without water. You have to have some kind of water, some kind of liquid inside of you. You have to have something going on in your life. Some kind of water. How many know that it's nice sometimes that after mowing the lawn or whatever, it's nice to go stand in the shower?
Yeah.
And just stand there in the water. How many have ever felt bad? Just stood in the water. In the shower. Amen. All the time. I thank God. When I grew up, we didn't have a shower. We had a bathtub. That's all we had. We didn't have fancy showers like you rich people. We had a bathtub. And we didn't get I went until I was grown and I got my own shower. I like it. And so I just stand in the water and just run over you. And just get as hot as you can. If I have a headache, I get in there as hot as I can stand it. And I feels better. Water. Water. Cleansing water. Without water, there's no life, and no life can exist. The earth is mostly water. Must be important. Our bodies are mostly water. Must be important. So if you have your Bible, I'm going to give you these scriptures. Put your finger there. And we're not going there yet. Just put your finger there. So when I say go there, you can just flip there. Exodus chapter 30. I'm not going to tell you what scriptures yet because you'll read them. And so listen to me. And then John chapter 13. Y'all be reading and not listening. I want you listening and not reading. Amen. We'll read here in a minute. Amen. Glory to the Lord. I'm excited about being in God's house this morning. Amen. Water. Water is the most important symbols also of spiritual things in the Bible. Water was used. I'll just give you a few examples. The four rivers of Eden in Genesis chapter 2, 11 through 14. The rivers that gave life to the garden. Water. Life-giving water. You can just write those down. We're not reading them. Genesis chapter 2, verse 11 through 14. You can read about the four rivers that ran into the Garden of Eden. And they brought life to the garden. It's water that brings you life.
Amen.
I'm not a big water drinker. Hey, you will be proud of me. I've gone 2 weeks with no Dr. Pepper, no caffeine.
Yeah.
2 weeks. 2 weeks. Oh, y'all didn't mean that. Okay, so y'all are like, big deal. Okay, so anyway, but 2 weeks for me is a long time. Dr. Pepper is taking a nosedive. If you have your money in stock in Dr. Pepper, take it out. Because it's been 2 weeks, and that's eventually it's going to affect them. But I did have caffeine because I got sweet tea at a restaurant. But I'm trying not to have any caffeine. I figure something that's got that much hold on me, I need to get rid of. And so it's going away. I'm not saying you're going to hell for drinking Dr. Pepper. Brother Jeff said we're going to hell for drinking. I did not say that. That something that has that much hold on my life, I need to get rid of it because it's not doing my body any good anyway. It's not helping me at all. And I do feel better. It seems like my mind's more clear. And maybe it's just because I'm not caffeinated up and just going nuts like a squirrel. But it's just I just do feel better. But the four rivers that came into the Garden of Eden that gave life to the garden. How about this? How about Hagar and her son, Ishmael? You remember that story when Abraham sent her out? Go, here's a bottle of water, a loaf of bread, good luck to you. And go out to the wilderness, and she lays the boy down, and goes a bow shot away, so she doesn't have to hear her son die. And the angel shows up, so the angelic water company came and shows up and opens her eyes, and she sees a well, and she gives water to the lad and to herself, and they live and they prosper. So Hagar and her son are saved by an angelic water. That's Genesis chapter 21, 17 through 19, if you're interested. Moses striking the rock to give the children of Israel water. Water, water, water. Water is life-giving. Water is cleansing. Water is refreshing. And sometimes we just need to take a drink. Can somebody say amen?
Yeah.
Say, I need a drink. Some of y'all said that like y'all said before. I need a drink. These kids drive me crazy. But how about this? How about the cleansing of Naaman in the River Jordan? How about that? And he had to go in and he had to dip seven times. That's 2 Kings chapter 5, 11 through 14, if you're writing things down. But the laver, the brazen laver that stood between the altar and the holy place. There is mud right here, wherever the laver would stand. Okay? The altar in the holy place. It would stand there as a symbol. As a symbol. Now we talked about last Sunday, we talked about the altar. How it has to, the altar is the was the first thing when you walked into the outer court. The altar was the first thing you would encounter. The altar was made out of wood and brass so it could withstand the sin, hold the sin, and burn the sin, right? We talked about that, right? Does anybody remember? Okay, we talked about that. And so we talked about how the weight of the sin had to be present, and how the stench of the sin burning needed to be present, because God is a visual God.
Amen.
If God wasn't a visual God, he didn't have to split the Red Sea and let him go on dry ground, but he did because he's a visual God. He could have done something else and made it where they could walk across the water, whatever, but he did a visual thing. It's made the Red Sea part, and they went across on dry ground. Does anybody remember the story? And so God is a visual God.
Amen.
He wants you to see what's going on in your life, and it is a type and a shadow, if you will, of the sin that we place in our lives, and the sin that Jesus takes out of our lives goes on the altar of God. And no, we don't see it physically anymore. No, we don't smell it anymore, but it should be the same thing in our lives. We should feel the weight and the weight released when we lay it on the altar, and it should burn up and be cast away by the blood of Jesus Christ. He takes away our sin, not just covers it, but takes it away. So water is used in many of the Levitical ceremonies. Water was used. Priests had to be set apart by cleansing. They had to go and cleanse themselves. The leper had to be washed. He had to wash himself with water, shaved, sprinkled with blood, and anointed with oil. Water of separation for those who touched anything that was dead had to be cleansed before entering the tabernacle. So water is very important to God. So what does that have to do with me today, Brother Jeff? Nothing. You don't have to go before God and wash yourself before you get to God. You don't have to clean yourself up before you get to God. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is this: water is essential to cleansing and showing what God does in our lives. He cleanses us. And before we can stand before God, we have to be cleansed. Now, we have to be covered in the blood. Yes, I get that. We have to be covered by the blood of the Lamb. We've got to be under the blood, because it's the blood that sets us free. It's the blood that keeps us safe. It's the blood of Jesus Christ. That's why I sang that song this morning. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon a cross. I know it was that precious blood for me. It's the blood of Christ and his blood alone that separates me and sets me free and saves my soul. Him and him alone. Nobody else can do anything for me but only Jesus Christ and his blood. I wish I could get some help this morning. The brazen laver or basin was formed out of brazen mirrors of the women of Israel who took them out of the land of Egypt. Now, I could go off on a bunny trail here, but I'm not going to, where God would eventually separate Israel from Egypt. But when you're 400 years of captivity in a place, you get some of the stuff.
Yeah.
You ever hear the expression, you lie with dogs, you get? No? I've not heard of fleas, okay? Anybody ever have a dog? Okay, four of us had dogs. The rest of y'all cat people. Okay. And anybody, if you lay with cats, you get fleas, okay? You lie with a dog, you get fleas. That's not a hard concept. Okay, and so that wasn't real spiritual. It was just kind of just throwing it out there. All right? Formed out of mirrors of women from Israel. They, the mirrors, were melted, then cast into the laver. They were made, it is a big mirror. It was a big mirror filled with water. It was a big mirror filled with water. Why? Because the priest, not everybody, but the priest, had to go and had to examine themselves in the mirror to make sure there was no dirt or spot or anything else that they had gotten from the altar. They had to go and make sure they were clean. And the water was a fountain. And that out of that fountain, there was water that ran. And that water would cleanse them. That water would cleanse them. That water would make them clean. And so they were able to go into the holy place of God. Listen, the mirrors, they melted down and cast it to the labor. They made it to the labor. But God began to take the things of Egypt away from Israel and consecrate them for His use. Now listen to me for just a second, please. Everything that you've been through in your life wasn't for your destruction. Even if you were not, listen to me, even if you were not living for God, some of the things you learned while out in the world, God is going to take those things, consecrate those things, and use those things for your benefit. Hear me. Some of the things you learned, we act like we didn't know that God was with us. Oh, I was a sin. God wasn't with me. God didn't know what I was doing. Honey, please. God knew exactly where you were at. He knew exactly what you did. Did He approve? No. He did not approve of everything that you had done. But one thing is this. He knew what you were going through. He took those things you were going through. Now He's consecrating them for His use, that you can be a blessing to somebody who's gone through those very things. But listen, God began to take the things away from the people of Israel and consecrate them for His use. The labor was in three parts. I know I'm talking fast, but I got a lot of stuff to say and a little bit of time to say it. There were three parts of the labor. It was a mirror, first of all, not for vanity or beauty. Make sure my tie is straight. Now listen, I don't normally wear black with gray in my Noah was the blood shirt. But it's been a long week, and I think I've worn everything that I have. Everything's at the cleaners. So there you go. This is what you get, baby. And so that's just how it goes. Anybody else ever have that problem? Okay, and so this is what you get. So if I was looking at myself in the vanity of the labor, I would look at myself and go, I wouldn't normally wear that, but it's all right. It looks all right. At least I'm dressed, thank God. My hair is combed, my teeth are brushed, I'm doing all right. But I start looking around, and this might need to go to the cleaners as well. Because it is black and everything shows up on it. And so, just letting you know that it was not there so they could say how good they looked to make sure their ephod was straight. It wasn't there so they could make sure that their robes were just right and straight. It was there to see if there was any dirt. There to see if there was any spot. And so it was not there to see beauty, but it was there to see blemishes. It was a fountain, a cleansing fountain. It was not there just to get a drink out of. It was there to cleanse away dirt. Number three, it had a basin at the foot that they could come and be cleansed, and they saw the filth that had come off of their garment. Hang with me just a minute. We're going to go somewhere. Tell your neighbor he's going somewhere. I don't know where he's going, but he's going somewhere. Oh, that was poor. I don't know where he's going, but he's going somewhere. All right. Buckle in. Put your seatbelts on. We're going somewhere. The labor was to be used by the priest only. Not everybody, but the priest. The priest only. Before they could even enter the holy place, they had to go check themselves out. They could not be in the presence of God with one spot or stain upon them. Go to Exodus. My scripture, I can't remember what. Exodus chapter 30. verse 17 through 21. We're going to read it. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Thou shalt also make a laver of brass, and his foot also of brass, to wash withal. And thou shalt put it between the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar, and thou shalt put water therein. For Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and feet thereat. Can't see this glare. When they go into the tabernacle of the congregation, they shall wash with water, and they shall die not. Or when they come near to the altar to minister, to burn offering made by fire to the Lord. So they shall wash their hands and their feet, that they die not, and it shall be a statue forever to them, even to them and to his seed throughout the generations. Where did I say to stop? I don't remember. That's it, right? That's it. Okay. You get the picture. God spoke to Moses and said, build this thing. Build this thing. Build it this way. Build it this direction. This is the way I want it. I want it this way. I think God's particular about the way he wants some things. I think God's particular sometimes of how he wants our lives to be. I don't think that we can live like hell and go to heaven. I know that messes people up. But I don't think that we can have the opportunity to live like hell and make it to heaven. That just doesn't make any good sense to me. I think God is particular in how he wants things done. And so when God gave Moses the instructions, he said Aaron and his sons are going to wash themselves before they ever do anything. They're going to wash themselves. The laver was used. The laver was used by the priest only. They could not be in the presence of God with a spot or a wrinkle upon them or a stain on them. They could not go to the brazen altar even until they had washed in the laver. The laver as a mirror reflected any spot or stain. Listen, how many ever heard this? Somebody say this to you? You can't judge me. You're right, I can't. You're supposed to judge yourself. You're supposed to look at yourself in the mirror of the Word of God and the Spirit of God and judge yourself. And if you see something there, you're supposed to wash yourself there. So that you can be in the presence of God. I'm supposed to wash myself. The water is also a type of the Spirit of the Lord. It shows in here, the Word of God shows that he's used symbolism of the Spirit of God. How he is washing you. Listen, you're washed and you're cleansed by the Spirit and the Word. And the washing by the water and the Word. We're washed away. The sins are washed away. God's Word is Spirit as a mirror. God has provided his Word as Spirit for us to discover our own unclean self. What do you guys have? What are you guys looking at? What do we read out of? The Bible. I told you Wednesday night, and if you weren't here, I'm sorry, but you'll have to catch up. Wednesday night, I told you that every verse of this Bible has been consecrated in the blood of Jesus. It is covenant blood. The covenant of God. If you will do this, I will do that. If you will give me your life, I will give you eternal life. The blood covenant. Every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. Every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. Everything that God has promised, I can have. Well, you can't have the promises of Israel. Oh, wait a minute. I thought I was grafted in the vine of the lineage of Abraham. I thought I was grafted in. I thought I was adopted in. I thought I was a son and no longer a servant. I thought I was able to be what God's called me to be. I thought I was at one time a prisoner, then a servant, now a son. I thought one time I was bound in bondage to sin, but he saved me. He redeemed me. He set me free. He made me a servant so I could learn how to be a son. And then he said, you're no longer a servant, but a son. Wait a minute. I thought all the blessings of God were mine. Don't you come to me and tell me I can't have what God told me I could have. Who do you think you are? You're not anybody, but God is going to tell you that you can have the blessings of the Lord. That's what he's going to tell you. The devil will come and tell you, oh, you can't have that. Excuse me. Who do you think you are, devil, to tell me I can't have what my heavenly Father says I already have? Who are you to tell me that I cannot the Father, the Father's table. Who are you to tell me that I am not worthy to stand before God? I am not worthy in myself, but He makes me worthy. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm glad I'm washed and I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I don't know about you. All Scripture is given for doctrine in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. You can read that later. But all Scripture is given for doctrine or instruction. You can read the whole thing. Listen, go ahead and throw it up there for me if you will. 2 Timothy 3:16. 2 Timothy 3:16. I hope that somebody's getting something out of that. I know I'm talking fast, but I got a lot to say. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine or instruction, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Go to 17, please. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished in all good works. What does that mean, Brother Jeff? That doesn't mean anything to me. This is what it means. I can take this word of God and I can inspect myself. As they used to stand in front of the brazen laver, I can now stand in front of God's word, and His Spirit will convict me of the things that are wrong in my life. And I have to change those things in order to be with God. Okay. Whatever. And I didn't say you... Oh, never mind. I got time for that. You've got to understand this thing. God is not going to allow sin to enter into the kingdom of God. If it's not under the blood, then it's in your life. Get it under the blood on the altar. Get it out of your life. Get the unforgiveness out of your life. Get the hatred out of your life. Get the whatever it is, get the greed out of your life. Whatever the situation or the sin, move it and remove it from your life. How do I do that, Brother Jeff? I'm so glad you asked. You come to an altar. I don't care if it's this one, your pew, the front seat of your car, your steering wheel. I don't care where it is. You come to an altar and say, Jesus, I need your cleansing power. I need your help. I'm talking to saved people that have stuff in their life that's hanging on through their lives, keeping you away from what God would have you to have, keeping you from the blessings of God, because you are so entangled with the junk in your life that you need to see that, yes, I am the priest of my home, but I may have a dirty sleeve I need to wash off. I may have a ring around the collar. I may need to get that out of there. And I stand before the Word of God and the Spirit of God, and He transforms my life and cleanses me as though I'm standing in front of a brazen laver, as the priests of old used to do. And they used to wash themselves clean. Does anybody hear me this morning? All Scripture is given for doctrine. The Holy Ghost is a gentle reprover, quickly telling us if we have fallen into sin. How many have ever done something that you knew was wrong, but you did it anyway? And the Holy Ghost says, excuse me. Excuse me, little man. What are you doing? Leave me alone, God. I'm enjoying my sin. Oh, it got quiet now. It got quiet now. How many have ever been about to say something and the Holy Ghost say, shut your stinking mouth. And you speak it anyway. Because it felt good to say it about them. It got quiet again. Yeah. How many have ever stood there and you knew you was wrong, but you weren't going to let somebody else know you were wrong? And you were like, now I'm going to date myself here just a minute, but you were like the fawns and couldn't say I was wrong. I remember, y'all didn't know happy days. Those kids are like, happy days? What in the world? Happy days. Okay, anyway. That was back in my childhood. Yes, we had a bathtub, not a shower. Okay, and so, letting you know, the Holy Ghost, we know His Word. We know God's Word, I'm sorry. And we know that the Holy Ghost comes and says, excuse me. But we step across that line anyway. Always knowing that we should not step across it, because you can't sin unless you should have the Holy Ghost say, tapping you on the shoulder, say, excuse me, little man. I don't know who you think you are or what you think you're doing, but you need to stop right now. right now, because you're fixing to cross that line. Some people call it your conscience. I call it the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And then I'm standing here and I'm washing myself and I look because I've made a misstep. I've given my sacrifice on the altar. I've done everything I was supposed to do, but I've misstepped. I've stepped over the line the wrong way. And the devil comes to you and says, "I knew it. It's all over for you, punk. You're done. I knew you couldn't live for God." And if you allow yourself, you'll get caught up in that mess. And if you allow yourself, you'll get caught up in all that tragedy and all that stuff in your life you think that you cannot get out of. And all the time, the whole time, Jesus is saying, "I paid it for you. All you got to do is come to me and I'll wash you clean. Listen, you see how dirty that sleeve is? I'll make it white again. You see how that hem of that garment is all messed up? I will fix that for you. But you've got to come to me. You've got to come look at yourself. Examine yourself." Listen, I think the hardest thing with Christians is we want to examine everybody else's stuff and never look at us. Just helping. I'm just helping. Just trying to help. But here it is. Listen, I've got enough stuff to deal with in my own life. I don't have to have to worry about your mess. I got my own family to mess with. I got my own crazy cousins and crazy aunts and uncles. Yours are your business. I've got my own crazy stuff going on. I'm a good neighbor. And as long as you don't get in my yard, we're good. We're good. Don't come in my yard. Listen, I had about 8 kids at our house last night. They're all Abby's friends. And I got to apologize to my neighbor because that patch of grass between my driveway and his ain't mine. Quit driving through it. And so they go through there, and of course it rained 97 inches yesterday. And so they go through it, so there's big old stinking ruts in his yard. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. Thanks, God. That's not my yard. That's Arliss's yard. And as long as Arliss stays on his side, I say, we're good. We're good. Because he mows it and it looks pretty. It looks really good. And so I'm just telling you, I'm a very good neighbor. Don't mess with me. I don't mess with you. I don't have time to mow your yard. I can't mow my own. I don't have time to mow your grass. I can't mow my own grass. And so hear me just a second. I don't have time to get in your business. And you shouldn't have time to be in my business. Amen. Boy, got quiet again. Amen. Yeah. You don't like it, but it's amen, right? Amen. I don't have time to get in your business. Stay out of mine. Let me look at my own praise and labor. Let me examine my own self. But the problem is this, is we don't like to examine ourselves. It's easier to look around the labor and see somebody else. Look how dirty they are. But I got a mud trail at my back, you know, from walking and flip-flops slipping in. Have you ever done that? Okay. Wearing flip-flops at the pool and throwing water all over. And so, you've done it if you wear more flip-flops. Okay. And so hear me just a second. And we're too busy looking at everybody else's junk to examine ourselves. Stop looking at everybody else. Let's take a second. Take a time out. Let's get in front of... Listen, you're the priest of your home, guys. Woo. I know that's hard, but you are. As daddy goes and mama goes, the house goes. And as the church goes, go with mom and daddy. Anyway. And so I'm just letting you know, you're standing there examining everybody else's garments. And the water is there to cleanse you. And if you'll cleanse you, then maybe somebody else will cleanse themselves and have to quit worrying about you.
Amen.
You. God's Word and Spirit, I'm sorry, is a mirror. God has provided His Word and Spirit for us to discover our own uncleanness. All Scripture is given for doctrine. Amen. The Holy Ghost is gentle reprover. The Holy Ghost is the one to knock on your door. Excuse me. And sometimes that knock gets loud. Sometimes sometimes that knock gets real loud. You know what I'm saying? You guys have been there. Anybody that's lived any length of time knows exactly what I'm saying. Anybody that's ever been saved knows what I'm saying. God's word shows us where we fall short. But the problem is that most people don't know what this is. They know what Joel said. They know what TD says. They know what somebody else on TV says. But they don't know what this says. And what this says matters. It's a filing cabinet, really. What this says matters. What Joel says is important, I guess. I don't know. It's up to you. But what God said is the important thing. What does he say about you? Does he say you're a dirty, rotten, sorry punk, you'll never be able to live for him? And that's not what he says. That's what the devil says. He says to you, you're blessed. He says to you, you are no longer a servant, but a son. He said, once you learn how to do the things that you need to do, you go from servanthood to sonship. That's another sermon for another time. Listen, you are not infallible, Pentecostals. I don't care what some slick-haired, shiny shoe preacher told you. You are not infallible. You are going to mess up. Gasp and swoon. You are going to mess up. You're going to make a misstep. You're going to lie. Oh! See, I lied when I said I had any caffeine. And I had tea. I lied. Didn't mean to, but I did. We're not infallible. We're not unreprovable. Be glad. Not in the fall, but that the fall shows you how to walk. We act like, in the Pentecostal circles, I can talk about Pentecostals because I have been one on off. And I won't get mad at me. But in the Pentecostal circles, we act like we're not walking 3 feet off the ground, then we've sinned against the Lord. We act like we'd never have a struggle. We're liars. We act like we've never had a problem. We act like we never had anything go wrong in our lives. I know this profession of faith, and I know I understand that. I get it. When we're walking in faith and not by sight, I get that. Listen, I'm not stupid. I get it. But when there's problems and trials in your life, listen, everybody that's breathing air has had something go wrong in your life. How many in here have a belly button? Then you've had problems. Okay, so if you've had a belly button, you've got problems. Because you are born into this planet and you have problems and situations. And how many know that you're going to mess up and take a misstep somewhere? And that's why Jesus came to lay our sins on the cross. And so we can go to him and say, Jesus, I messed up. Please forgive me. And let's go on and go forward. But as long as we act like we've never done anything wrong. As long as we act like we're never, ever wrong. And don't you dare reprove me, preacher. You're going to be stuck. You'll be stuck in sin because we refuse to look at ourselves in our nastiness and our filthiness of sin. I have this problem with preachers who get behind the Word of God and give a book report, but they don't ever say anything because they're afraid they're going to make somebody upset. It's time for preachers to preach. And let the chips fall where they may. With love and with understanding and not hatred and not judgment. I had enough of that growing up as a kid. Every sermon was everybody's going to hell. And they may have been. I don't know. I was just a little kid. I don't remember. But every sermon seemed to be about everybody was going to hell. We preached people into hell, didn't give them a way out. And I know that the pendulum swung the other way. It's all about grace and everybody's going to heaven. Hallelujah. Praise God. I think we're somewhere in the middle. But it's time for preachers to get a backbone and preach. It's time for preachers to stand up and tell the truth. What does the Word of God have to say about it? It's time for us to stand up and do what's good. And listen, preacher, don't clap your hands until you examine yourself and cleanse yourself. Because if you don't, then you're going to go before these people and you're going to say something and your dirt's going to show. And you can say everything you want to say, but you let one dirty spot, and it's over. All right, hang on. Someone say, please hurry. I'm trying. Be glad not in the fall, but the fall shows you how to walk. Don't turn away. I'm about done. I just have this right here, okay? Don't turn away from the Bible. It shines in the dark places of your life. Please understand me. Please hear me. This right here. This. I don't care if you have NIV, King James, New King James, American Standard Version. I don't care if you have Amplified, whatever you have. The Word of God will shine into the recesses of your heart. But the problem is that nobody wants to deal with that. Nobody wants to deal with their own sin. Let's clear the stage until the light of the Bible shines down into the darkest recesses of my spirit, and I find those things that I've hidden, and I give those things to the Lord, and the Lord cleanses me, and the Lord takes hold of my life, and it's God who raises me up. It's God who cleanses me. Thank God I don't have to go before a basin of water anymore. I don't have to clean myself up before I go into a holy place of God. I just have to walk up to the Lord and say, God, please help me and save me. Help me this morning, somebody. Listen, don't shrink from prayer because it convicts us of our shortcomings. Most people don't pray because they don't want to hear what God has to say. People pray when they're in trouble. I got time to go there. Remember, the labor that shows us our sin contains the water that cleanses our sin. Hear me this morning. The same water, the same place that shows me my sin is the place that I'm cleansed from sin. And so when I get into the Word of God and I pray and I seek God's face, though He convicts me, He is the only one that can take the sin away. Understand what I'm telling you? He's the only one that can cleanse me as well as show me, but cleanse me. The Word of God that shows us our sin will also cleanse us of our sin if we apply it to our lives. Remember, the Word of God is covered in the blood of Jesus, which takes away the sin of the world. Last scripture, and I'll leave you alone. 1 Corinthians 11, 28 through 32. I know I didn't read John, and I'm sorry. I thought I would skip ahead. You guys can read it later. 1 Corinthians 11, 28 through 32 says, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. This is talking about communion. Verse 30. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. 31. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. I'm just trying to help you. Hear me. It's time we stand in judgment of ourselves. I'll give you the last thing I'm going to give you. In the hog pen, the prodigal son came to himself and said, what on God's green earth am I doing here? And he examined himself for where he was, what he was doing, and where he was going. He was starving to death. He was dying of thirst. He had nothing to wear but rags. He was feeding pigs as he wasn't even supposed to touch. He had all these things going on in his life. And he knew at that point, in that moment, he had gone as far as he could go in himself. And he judged himself not to be worthy. Hear me. He judged himself not to be worthy. But when he came to the Father, what did the Father say? Okay, the Father said this. Go get the best robe of God. Go get a ring put on his finger. For my son who was dead is now alive, who was lost and is now found. Amen. The Father made him worthy. The Son counted himself unworthy, though he was. But the Father made him worthy when he came back and he put the robe on his back, put the ring on his finger, and said, you are still my son. Regardless of what these people are saying about you, you are still my son. Regardless of what your older brother says about you, you are still my son. And the same way, when I come back to the Father, though I have been tattered and torn and sin stained. Amen. When I walk into the presence of my Father, I'm still His son.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He does not condemn me nor judge me for where I've been. He loves me, hugs my neck, kisses me, throws a robe on me, puts a ring on my finger, and tells the servants to go get my boys some stuff.
Amen.
I'm not His servant, I'm His son. I am His servant, but I'm His son. You better hear me this morning. Well, what does that have to do with water, Brother Jeff? You started off about water. Here it is. Here it is. The spiritual water that cleanses us is found in the Word of God and the Spirit of God.
Amen.
You cannot get where you're going without the spiritual water to cleanse those things from your life. I know it's the blood of Jesus that makes you whole. I know it's the blood of Jesus that cleanses sin out of your life. I'm talking about smudges and things that when we fall, when we're in trouble, when we take a misstep, when we mess up, and I didn't say you had gone back and committed sin all over again to the point that you need to come back and lay another sacrifice on the altar. Didn't say that. What I said is when you mess up, you misstep, and you get dirty. You've got to come back and get clean.
Amen.
And when you get clean, you're in the presence of the Father again.
Amen.
You understand me, what I'm telling you?
Yes.
Is that any good? You're looking at me like I'm an idiot. I just want it to be to where you understand what I'm telling you. I'm not telling you you're all going to hell. I didn't say that. If you've messed up, I didn't say you need to go sacrifice a goat, throw it on an altar. I didn't say that. What I said is, in the old time, there was a brazen laver that you examined yourself and you cleaned yourself. Now, there is a God who has given you the ability to go to Him and be cleansed again. Cleaned up and transformed. If you will bow your head with me, I'm going to get you out of here. I promise you I would. If you're in this place this morning and you don't know this Jesus, or maybe you've just gotten dirty, you need to get clean. You need to get clean. There is a place in God that you need to get. There is a place you need to get there. And there's a place before the Lord. Stand there and say, God, I need to be cleansed. I need to be cleansed. If you're here this morning and you don't know this Jesus, I would love to pray with you. Would you raise your hand and say, Brother Jeff, I don't know Him and I'd love to know this guy you're yelling about for an hour. I would love to know who it is. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hey, maybe you've just gotten dirty. Listen, quit worrying about it being after 12 o'clock. Tell that belly God to shut up. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. We're talking about people's souls. Talk about people's souls. Their lives being transformed. Hear me for just a second. Father, I know there's some here. You wouldn't give me this message to preach if not. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I ask that you touch the lives of your people. Holy Ghost, begin to convict people of their sin. God, you see the need. God, show them, convince them of their sin. Show them. Show them of what God, what you can do. Father, I give you praise for it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. You can look up. Listen, I have asked for 6 weeks. God has given me messages to preach about sin and getting cleansed for 6 weeks. And no one, I know it's not true. God would not give me the message I preached, but He's trying to get somebody's attention. I don't care if it takes 8 weeks, 10 weeks, 12 weeks, whatever it takes. I'm going to preach what God gave me to preach. And I hope that the Holy Ghost convinces you of sin. And I hope that you can listen. It's not about a show about, well, I got to come up there. I'm not going to drag you up here by the hair and hold you down until you get saved. That is not my deal. I'm going to give you an opportunity. I'm going to throw Jesus in your face and make you deal with it. Jesus can deal with you a whole lot better than I can. And I don't know what your life has been like, and I don't know what's entailed in your life, and all the trials and tribulations of your life, but the devil has told you that you're not worth it, you're not any good, the devil's a liar. God's trying to get your attention and let you know that you're worth it. You're worth it. He'll leave 99 to go get one. He'll leave all of us to go get you. You're worth it. Don't let the devil tell you you're not. I pray you got something out of this morning. If you did not, sorry, I did my very best. Did my very best to preach into your life and speak into your life. Did my very best. If you would, stand on your feet with me this morning. Don't let this day go past without making things right with the Lord. Make things right. Make things right. Don't go to hell with your eyes wide open. Oh, it'll never happen to me, Brother Jeff. I have plenty of time. Maybe you do. I don't know. But I know this, God's dealing with you and knocking at your heart. I know that. He's dealing with you. He's dealing with you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for another opportunity to preach your word today. I thank you for these people you have brought to this house. I thank you for just being who you are in my life and touching our lives and blessing me. Brothers, we are dismissed this morning from your service. I ask that you just be with each and every one of us. Keep us safe as we travel to where we're going today. Bring us back safely tonight at 6 o'clock to be in your house. Another appointment with the Holy God at 6 o'clock. And Father, I give you the praise for it, the honor for it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen.